got that good feeling, kicking me out of my chest, dancing like I don't care.
You are here and that you have chosen to worship with us on this beautiful Sunday. And we are in a sermon series right now, as you just watched, entitled, What Moves You? What moves you? What really, honestly, truly, like, gets you going? What is it that moves you? Kind of our focus for this entire series over the next few weeks is this: what you truly value will drive you, propel you, will move you. You know, you can say that you value something or you believe something or something is important to you, but the reality of that is what you truly value is what's going to motivate you. It's what's going to propel you. It's what's going to drive you. It's ultimately what is going to move you. And the passage of scripture, kind of our series passage, is Exodus 14:15, and it says this: Then the Lord said to Moses, Why are you telling me, or why are you crying out to me? Tell the people to what? Get moving. Tell the people to get moving. And here's the context of that passage of scripture. The children of Israel have finally escaped from Egyptian captivity. Pharaoh has finally let them go. They have escaped. They're headed towards the promised land. But scripture tells us that the Lord hardens Pharaoh's heart and he gets angry again and he's upset that they have escaped. And so he sends after the children of Israel 600 charioteers and their commanders and all of the army. And so here are the children of Israel. And the Red Sea is before them, and their enemies are behind them. And so they begin to cry out to the Lord and say, Lord, what do we do? Help us. And the Lord says, Have I not shown you enough? Have I not already shown you the miracles that I can perform and that I will perform? And I've rescued you. And he says to Moses, he says, Raise your staff up over the water, and the water will divide. It will split in two, and you will walk across on dry land. So quit crying out to me and get moving, right? Get moving. And you know, there is a time and there are seasons of waiting and there are seasons of seeking and there are seasons of being very patient and there are seasons in which we are called to do that. But then when the Lord speaks and he gives us clear direction and he has instructed us what to do, even when there is a body of water in front of us and our enemies are behind us and it feels like it's closing in and it feels like it is impossible, the Lord says, just get moving. Just get moving. And so over the next few weeks, we really want to talk about then what is it that gets you moving? What is it that propels you? Last week, we talked about being propelled by prayer. And so because we believe that it's our core values ultimately that will move us, we've been kind of tying into this, what are the core values of the Well Church? We've gone through our vision and we've gone through our mission, but our core values here at the church, number one is prayer. We will do nothing. We will go nowhere. We will make no decisions if it has not been completely bathed in prayer. And then we will be propelled by those prayers. And that's what we talked about last week. Today we're going to talk about people. You see, core value number one is prayer. Number two is people. Number three is passion, and number four is process. So we're going to get to passion and process later. We've already covered prayer. Today, I want to talk to you about what it is to be propelled by people. To be propelled by people. For us, people are core value number two, because once we have taken everything to the Lord in prayer, we believe that everything He has called and equipped us to do here at the Well has to revolve around people. If we are here for any other reason than to share the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ with people, we're missing it. People, people. To be propelled, to be moved, to be motivated by people. And so really, this morning, I'm excited for some of you. Some of you already have. Some of you are in the process. But to begin to process, who are your people? Who are your people? So I have a picture I wanted to share with you this morning. And this picture was taken 17 years ago, and I know it was 17 years ago because Krenna, our daughter, is sitting on the table in her baby carrier, and she is now 17 years old. So it was almost 17 years ago, and that's John in the front, and he has not aged one day in 17 years. Isn't that amazing? And I'm kind of back in the corner. This was our youth room at our church, and I was so thrilled because we had just redone our youth room, and you can't really tell, that back wall was water, and we had fish all around the room because the theme was diving in, because back in the day, there was a song by Stephen Curtis Chapman called Diving In. Anybody? Anybody remember that song? Not very many of you, I know, and so we were going deeper. We were diving in, And I share this picture with you. Some of you have heard me share my story. John and I had just graduated from college, and this was about 5 years into youth ministry when we actually had a youth room. When we originally started, we were in the choir closet at our church. The only place for the teens to meet was the choir closet, and you could fit six people in the choir closet, but that wasn't a problem because there were only like four of us. You know, and we began to just kind of volunteer at church because they needed somebody to volunteer, and so we were volunteering with the youth. But it didn't take us very long to figure out that those were the people who propelled us. It didn't take us very long to figure out that we were moved, that we were motivated, that we were compelled to reach and teach teenagers. And so for 6 years, you know, John and I just volunteered. John worked his regular job. For part of those years, I was a high school speech and theater teacher. For part of those years, I was a stay-at-home mom. I was still in school, and we had our babies. And let me just tell you, mamas, just strap them on and get after it, right? Sit them on the table, teach your lesson. And I'm being compassionate here. I'm not being hateful because, you know, we have so many excuses, right? Well, my kids are too young or this or that or I can't. Yes, you can. I think the Lord said get moving. Okay, so just whatever your excuse is, you know, just take those babies, take whatever you have to do. You know, that's part of the process. It's okay. I think our kids are better off because of it, because we just did what God called us to do, and they were never, ever, ever an excuse. They were part of it. That's how they were raised. And so I just want to encourage you this morning. You know, it's not like I set out to be a pastor or even a youth pastor or anything like that. There was a position in our church where they needed a volunteer. And they said, hey, would you consider volunteering in this capacity? But here's what I want you to hear. It wasn't out of guilt. It wasn't out of necessity. It eventually became that I was so motivated and moved and propelled because I had found my people, and nothing could have kept me away from those teenagers. I loved them, and all I wanted to do was pour my life and my heart and my money and my house and my cars and my children and anything that I had into them because they so propelled me. And you might say, well, Selena, that's awesome. But what about me? And I want you to know this morning that if you are a follower of Christ, you are called to make disciples. You are called to reach people. I just think maybe you haven't found your people. Because once you find the people that God has called you to and is leading you to and is calling you to, you will be so propelled by the power of the Holy Spirit of God that you can't help but make disciples. You can't help but walk that out with people. I think so often we think that God is just going to call us into situations where we're miserable. Now listen, He definitely calls us into situations where we're uncomfortable. The Lord really don't give a rip if you're comfortable or not. I mean, He doesn't. But yet He has created you and He has gifted you in such a way that there are certain people and individuals that you can reach, that you could disciple in a way that I could not. And so here's how a theologian, Frederick Buchner, says it. I was going to Google his name and I forgot, so I'm not sure if that's pronounced correct. It says this: vocation is where our greatest passion. Next week we're going to talk more about passion. Your vocation is not just a job or a career. It's literally what you've been wired to do. Your vocation is where your greatest passion meets the world's greatest need. We know this world's full of needs. And I know you're full of passion. So it's not about taking your passion and fitting it where there's no need. And it's not trying to fill a need where you have no passion. It's taking your greatest passion and the world's greatest need and them coming together and meeting. It says, I believe that all of us have the capacity to live out our passion in a manner that serves others and ultimately changes the world in our own small way. The same God who created our lives for serving, you know, people always want to know, what am I here for? What is my purpose? What is God's will for my life? It is your purpose that you would serve, that you would glorify God, that you would bring glory to God, that you would be His hands and feet. It says the same God who created our lives for serving others is the same God who gives us the passion to serve. Because as you begin to pour out your life, as you begin to pour out your giftings and as you begin to be propelled by people because you're just motivated, you just want to move in a direction that would move them. As you are poured out, you will be filled back up. But if you're never pouring out what the Lord has given to you, it becomes stagnant. And it becomes dirty, and it becomes useless. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about the woman at the well, and he talked about the water of life, the living water that was fresh and clean and bubbling up. It was a bubbling spring. In order for you to have that bubbling spring that's filling you and charging you and motivating you and moving you and driving you and compelling you and moving you, you got to be pouring something out. John and I were 25 years old when we had the amazing opportunity for a young woman to come and live with us. She's actually here this morning. Her name's Angela. And she was our foster daughter. We were only about 7 years older than she was. And it was such a blessing from God. And people were like, you know, why? You're 25. You have a brand new baby. Why would you do this? Because the Lord commanded us to. He directed us to, and I knew her, and I loved her, and we had a relationship with her, and I was so moved by her, and I was so moved by the dreams and the goals that she had for her life. that I couldn't help but do what the Lord had asked me to do. And you know, then I think about the 10 years between Angela and Dylan that we spent in ministry with teenagers in our home, and we were just moved to do that. And then Pastor Dylan came and he lived in our home, and then we've planted the church and all of these things. And I tell you this morning, just to give you an example, your people will look very different than my people. But I believe with all of my heart that the greatest gift and blessing that John and I ever had in our marriage is that we were so propelled by people. We were so moved by people. We were so driven to reach people. We didn't have time to gripe and argue and fight and nitpick with one another, because we were just pouring out. And as we were pouring out, the Lord was filling us up. And you got to understand that one of the most impactful things you can do for your Christian walk, for your Christian life, is that you would allow people to propel you. Are you following me this morning? You get me, right? To be propelled by people. Because here's the other end of that. If you give your life to Christ and you come in relationship to Him, with Him, and He begins to speak, and He begins to talk, and He begins to direct, and He begins to challenge you and ask you to move, and you never move, you'll become depressed and stagnant and angry, and you won't even know why, and you won't know why the arguments are happening in your home, and you won't know why the arguments are happening with you and your children, and things just, there's just something not right, and so then you think, well, I sure can't minister because everything's a mess, and the more it's a mess, the more the enemy convinces you you can't minister. But in reality, that's what you need to do. You need to begin to focus on other people. You need to begin to pour yourself out for others. Here's our scripture for today, Matthew 28, 19 through 20. This is the Great Commission, and this is what it says. These were Jesus' last words to his disciples, the Great Commission. Many of you have heard it said probably that Jesus called it the Great Commission, and we have changed it into the Great Omission. This is what he's asked us to do, and we omit doing it in every way. It says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey the commands I have given you, and be sure that I am with you always, even to the end of the age. The last words, the last commandment of Jesus is that we as his disciples, we as his church would go and make disciples, that we would baptize, and that we would teach others to obey his commands, and that he would be with us and he would enable us to do that. So I'm going to spend just a few minutes this morning unpacking that, to make disciples. You know, we use that word a lot in the church, and I'm just being very honest. I think very few of us really know what that means. I had a wonderful meeting with a very godly woman the other day, and she was asking me. She said, Selena, I have a lot of people asking me if I would mentor them. And she said, I've just been trying to figure out, what is the difference between me mentoring someone or me actually discipling someone? She said, is it the same thing? And so I began to think, and I kind of gave her what I thought, and then I thought, well, I better study that a little bit and make sure that what I said was correct. And it definitely is. To mentor someone is to help them improve in a specific area. You know, someone can come along and mentor you in business. They can mentor you in playing the piano. They can mentor you in planting your garden. They can come along and they can mentor you. They can help you improve something you're already doing. But to disciple, which is wonderful, mentors are wonderful, but to truly disciple someone, to truly disciple is where you're coming along someone, and it's the whole person. It's not just one area. And it's not about improving on something they're already doing. It's about bringing change and complete and total transformation into their lives. And that's what we are called to do. We're not called to just come along and pat everybody on the back and clap along and yay, yay, and let's try to improve. I think that's what we do in the church sometimes, really. You know, I think we say, hey, let's just do a little better. Let's just try a little harder. And to mentor someone is to come alongside them in the power of the Holy Spirit of God, that they would be holistically changed and transformed, that their life would be made new. So number one, discipleship is holistic. It's the whole person. It's not just a slice of their life. You know, you can teach someone to make better brownies, and it doesn't change their thoughts or their attitudes or their words or their actions. They just make better brownies. But if you're going to come along someone and disciple them, their mind will be transformed. Their actions will change. Their words will change. It's holistic. The next thing we have to understand about discipleship is that it requires a model. It requires a model, and here's why we don't disciple people. You are the model. That's a scary thing. Here's what the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11:1. He says, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. You see, to disciple someone is to come alongside them and to provide that model of what it looks like to seek God in prayer and to seek God in His Word and to seek God in those everyday, ordinary life decisions. It requires being a model to someone. The other thing that you need to know is that to be a disciple maker, the making of disciples must be intentional. You are not going to accidentally make a disciple of Christ, right? It's intentional. It's, you know, oftentimes when people ask to be mentored, it's because they know that they need to get better at something. They need to improve at something. When we come along someone in discipleship, oftentimes the Lord asks us to reveal things to them that they don't yet know is a problem. It's hard. And it takes incredible amounts of prayer and trust and reliance upon the Holy Spirit of God. And so to disciple someone is to come up with a plan to help them move forward, to help them cast vision, to help them understand where their life is not lining up with what God would have them to do or not to do. And probably the best thing about disciple making is that it is generational. It's generational. If you disciple someone, if you create a disciple of Jesus Christ, they will create other disciples. In fact, most people would say you can't truly claim to be a disciple of Christ until you have produced a disciple. And once you've produced a disciple, if it's a true disciple, that disciple will produce a disciple. You see, it's not about addition. Jesus is all about multiplication, because his will is that no one would perish, that all would know him, that all would be in relationship with him. Disciples who make disciples who make disciples who make disciples. Are you propelled by people? Who are you discipling? The next thing says that not only will we make disciples, but we will make disciples of all nations. In Acts 1:8, it says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem and throughout Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will be my witnesses. I mean, there's just no getting around it. And so when you look at this passage of Scripture, Jerusalem would have been in the context of their home and family. Before you disciple anybody else, the Lord has called you to disciple your children and your spouse, to make disciples, to make followers of Christ within your home and your family. And then it says Judea. Judea would have been like the neighborhood. You know, John and I have talked about this before. It's one thing for me to come and to help lead you and to pastor you and to shepherd you. But how am I doing in my little neighborhood? How am I doing in my community? How am I doing with the lady who checks me out at Walmart or the grocery store or the people that I come in contact with on a regular basis, right? Because we're called that we would reach not only our family and we would make disciples with our family, but also those that are in our neighborhood, those are who are in our friend group, those are who are in our core. And then it says Samaria. And Samaria would be the place that would be unfamiliar and certainly uncomfortable. Where is it that God would use you or has called you to go and make disciples that you know what he's asking you to do, but to just be honest, it's so uncomfortable and it's so unfamiliar and it just seems like it would be such an impossible thing to do. We're called to make disciples of all nations. And then it says to the ends of the earth. To make disciples. It makes me think about when we make disciples who make disciples who make disciples who make disciples. One of the greatest things in my life was mentoring young men and women and discipling them as they grew up. And there's both young men and young women who are in ministry today. There's four young women who are now full-time ministers in the Church of the Nazarene that John and I had the incredible privileges of discipling. One of them is ministering in Hawaii. One is ministering in Florida. One is ministering in Oregon, and one is ministering in Kansas City. And you know, that's kind of what we're talking about, is when you make disciples who make disciples who make disciples who make disciples who go out, who go here. I may never make disciples personally, you know, in other nations, but there are people who you will disciple, who will disciple people that will reach people in Judea and in Samaria and in to the ends of the earth. It's so important that we understand that. That's what discipleship is. The last thing it says to baptize and teach. Baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit and teaching them. It's more than just cheering people on. They have to be taught God's word. 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17 says this, all scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong, and it teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip his people for every good work. You cannot make a disciple without teaching them the word of God. But here's what I want to challenge you. Teaching somebody the word of God doesn't always have to be across the table in a quiet room with papers and pens and pencils. In fact, I think sometimes that's one of the least effective ways to teach people the Word of God. Teaching people the Word of God is to be in relationship with Him, to show them by example. We had a gentleman that we got to meet with a few weeks ago, and he talked about how God had been using him in ministry. He was asked to fill in a Sunday school classroom years ago. He's a hunter and a fisher, and he was asked to fill in this little third through fifth grade boys' Sunday school class. And he said he was terrified and he didn't want to do it. And they gave him this book that had the curriculum where the kids were all supposed to sit down at the table with their pens and papers and learn scripture and all these things. And he said, I tried to do that for a couple of weeks. And he said, I was terrible and I couldn't keep their attention. And so I said, one Sunday morning, this was in Texas, he said, I took those three or four little boys, I took them outside. We went outside the church, and I began to talk to them about nature, and I began to talk to them about hunting and fishing, and they were so engaged, and I began to tell them about who God was through nature. And that Sunday school class of three or four boys grew to over 40 young men. And then people from other churches began to ask him, how are you doing that? What are you doing? How are you having that kind of impact on all these little boys? Like, everybody's friends were coming for Sunday school and all of this. And so he wrote a curriculum. This is a young man who was abandoned at 13. He just wrote a book called Year 13, because that was the year that his mom and dad literally dropped him off on the side of the road, and he was abandoned. And he wrote a curriculum. And in this curriculum, it was to teach young men how to know God through nature. And so he shared that with some of the churches in his community. And now this curriculum, it's called Kids Outdoor Zone, is in over 80 churches across the United States. Because he was asked to fill in, to volunteer, you know, kind of like John and I, to volunteer, to lead a couple of teenagers. Here's what I want you to know this morning. You can't help everyone. You can't help everyone. You cannot save everyone. You cannot disciple everyone. But you can disciple someone. I'm going to say that one more time. You can't help everyone, but you can help, you can lead, you can guide, you can disciple someone. Amen? Amen? So then I began to think about our own church and some of the people in our church, and I thought about my sister-in-law. Her name's Anita. And there are a lot of things you would never know about Anita, because she'd want to know. I didn't even know if she would let me share this. But she said it would be okay. About 8 years ago, someone in the church she was attending approached her and said, "Hey, I'm doing a jail ministry, and I just thought maybe you would like to come with me." And so she went, and she went for a season, but she was a basketball coach, and so her schedule didn't allow her to go as much as she liked, and so then she quit going for a season. And then her schedule changed, and she still felt very moved by those people. And so she went back into prison ministry, and she's done it, you know, really on her own for the last 3 years. Primarily in Webster County, she goes and she meets with these women, and she prays with these women, and she disciples these women. These women who have become her friends, who she takes and receives communion with, who she studies the Bible with, who many of them, you know, once they have gotten out, have come to our church, come with her, and we've met some of them and had the amazing opportunity to even go with her and see several be baptized. You see, I didn't organize that. The church didn't organize that. There's no budget. There's no agenda. She was just moved. She was just propelled. And I'm going to say that was probably not a real comfortable thing to go into. I've been a little bit like Jesus and the woman at the well going into Samaria. A little uneasy, a little uncomfortable. And yet she was propelled to do it. I think about Trisha. She's a young woman in our church. And Trisha, about a year ago, went to a life group. And in the life group, she learned about Revelation Fitness, and she learned about what it is, body, mind, and soul, and to be, you know, one in Christ and to be whole from the inside out. And for the very first time, she fasted, and she said that through her fast, the Lord just completely rewired her mind and her brain and the way she thought about things and the way that she thought about health and taking care of herself and her body being the temple of God. And in that, she lost like 70 pounds and just became healthy. And then she went and went through a training called Revelation Wellness, and she became an instructor where she could now meet with women and not only teach them about health and fitness, but about Jesus Christ. And she's now created a life group here in our church. And you know, Trisha, that's how God spoke to her. That's how God, you know, commanded her, moved her, propelled her. And so now she's using what God's done in her life to reach other people because she's been moved by it. We have a gentleman in our church, his name is Bob, and Bob has so blessed my heart. And Bob will tell you he's had triple bypass surgery. He's had two strokes. I mean, he's retirement age. You know, Bob could just kind of check out and nobody would really give him a hard time. For 12 years, he has written letters to men and women who are incarcerated, who have a life sentence. He writes them And about a year ago, Bob said, I just didn't feel like I was doing enough. And so he got online and he Googled volunteer opportunities in Springfield, and he was led to the Victory Mission. And Bob is teaching a program at Victory Mission called Jobs for Life, where he goes in and literally mentors and disciples men, where they could learn how to go out into the workforce and to obtain jobs. And Bob could just check out. If you're here and you think, I've done my part, I've done my share, let me tell you, the Lord has something more for you. Every one of us, my husband this morning, bless his heart, John, for years he's tried to convince me that golf was his ministry, and you know, we've gone round and round about that. But I'm telling you right now, three of our very best friends, godly men in this church, their lives have been impacted through the golf game. Through playing golf and hanging out and coming to church. And now we all go to church together. And so John's starting a new life group for men who want to play golf and study the Bible. I don't know. Ask him about it. You need to go. But here's what I want you to hear me say this morning. So many times we think, I don't have to do that. That's not for me. Yes, you do. The Lord's last commandment to you, if he could look you in the eye, if he could look at you face to face right now, he would say to you, go and make disciples. Go and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. When was the last time that someone was baptized because you were so propelled by people that you couldn't help but come alongside them and teach them the Word of God and encourage them and help them to walk out the life that God has created them for? And these are the people that are in your life every day who you love, your friends and your family. Baptizing them and teaching them to obey the Word of God. And sometimes the very best way you can teach the Word of God is to live it in front of them. When somebody does this on the golf course, I don't know, maybe I shouldn't use that example. You do this. You know, when somebody does, you're just teaching them by example. I also want to go back to the focus. Why don't you stand with me this morning? You will be moved to make disciples when people propel you. You will be moved to make disciples when people propel you. Simple response this morning. You gotta find your people. You gotta find your people. You gotta ask the Lord, Lord, who is it? Is it the single mom? Is it the working mom? Is it my friend on the golf course? Is it teenagers? Is it children? Is it kids in foster care or men in recovery? Who are your people? Because once you find them, oh man, they're going to propel you. They're going to propel you. Father, I just come to you right now, Lord, in this place. Father, I thank you for who you are. God, I thank you for this incredible thing. Father, when I look out amongst this crowd of people this morning, God, these are people that I know. These are people that I love. God, these are people that you have called into this body, into this place. And God, I'm not talking about coming along and it may start a ministry in the church. It could. But God, them personally, them, each person. Right now, Lord, my prayer is that every person would own this. That every person would own this. This isn't for your neighbor. It's for me. It's for you. The Lord has asked you, he has commanded you to make disciples, to teach people, to lead them into baptism. The crazy thing is, the person that will be changed the most is you, every single time. You think that you are going to change the life of someone else. Angela changed our life. Dylan changed our life. You have changed our life. God, would you just begin to speak? And I'm going to invite you, as always, the altars are open this morning. We're asking you to move. Oh, how easy it would be to just stay seated. Pretend like this message was for somebody else, for some other time. It's for you, and it's for today. I don't know who your people are. Don't come and ask me who your people are. I don't know who your people are. The Lord's going to tell you who your people are. I'm going to invite you as we begin to sing this morning to just come and to just fill these altars. Do you want to be propelled by people this morning? Maybe the prayer is, Lord, would you just give me a heart for people? Would you give me a heart, Father, for my friends and my family and my neighbors and those in my community and those who are uncomfortable to go to and those people, Lord, that I will never, ever meet at the ends of the earth. God, would you just give me a heart, Father, for those people, for those individuals? Ask the Lord who your people are. I promise you, he's going to show you. He's going to move you and propel you. And you're not just going to change their life, it's going to change your life. Father, we praise you, and I ask these things in Jesus' name. These altars are open.